Okay, well, this PowerPoint video is going to cover chapter 3. It's going to be part 1. I'm going to split this chapter into two videos, as I have been the other ones as well, so they're not too long for one setting. Chapter 3 covers network protocols and communications. And so let's, if I can get the slide to advance here, the objectives for this section. Or what you should be learning out of chapter 3 is explain how we use rules to facilitate communication. Explain the rules, a role of protocols and standards. Why do we have protocols? Why do we have standards, standardization in networking? And then explain how devices on a LAN, local area network, access resources in a small to medium-sized business network. So like I said, we're going to split this into two parts. Part one is going to be three rules of communication, network protocols, and then part two will be how we move data in the network. So let's move on here with part one. And first, we have to understand what is communication. When we're dealing with networking, we can really say that networking is a lot like human communication. To communicate, how I like to always say it is, if I speak German and somebody else and you speak French, we probably, and you don't speak French, or excuse me, you speak French, I speak German, you don't speak German, and I don't speak French, we are going to have a tough time communicating. There may be some words that we understand, but and over time we can learn how to communicate because we'll learn a common language or we'll learn each other's language, but that's the only way that we're going to effectively communicate. We can hear each other, but we will not be able to understand each other. And we can take that whole understanding and move that to the networking side. I can send an electrical signal across a wire, but unless the other end of the wire can understand what I'm sending, if they, it's just noise to them. It's just noise. It's electrical, and that's it. So we have to set protocols. And we have to set ways that we're going to communicate between each other. So we have the message source, we have the signal or some way to transmit it. Let's say our voice, we're going to talk. We have to have a transmission medium. We have to be a certain distance from each other. If we're too far away, we're not going to be able to talk. Or are we going to use our voices? Or we're going to use a phone device? Or are we going to record that information and send it that way? Are we going to use put two tin cans with a string between them. How are we going to communicate? What is the medium? What's going to be the basis for us to be able to communicate back and forth? And then the receiver gets the signal and then decodes the message. So in the same way, when we communicate in networks, we have to establish rules. We have to identify who the sender and receiver is. We have to agree upon, and this is an important part, we have to agree upon the method of communication, whether it's face-to-face, telephone, letter, photograph, however we're going to communicate. We have to agree upon the common language and the grammar. We have to agree upon the speed and timing of the delivery. Am I talking too fast? Am I talking too slow? Is my dialect enough for you to understand? It's the same process for speech as it is for networking. And then we have to confirm or acknowledge the requirements. If I'm just talking for 10 minutes and I don't get any acknowledgement but that the other person has heard me and understood me, then how do I know that my information got through? How am I supposed to get back? So if I ask a question and I say, "What color is the sky?" and the person doesn't respond to me, then my communication didn't go through properly. I did not get an acknowledgement back. So when we encode our messages, this is much like we would do in regular speech. We do our message source, we encode it, we put it in some type of package. We might write our message down on a piece of paper. We might record our message on an audio or maybe a PowerPoint, or we record it in some manner. We transmit that. The medium is the transmission. That might be email. We might hand deliver it. The receiver gets it. They decode it. They might open up the email. They might take that audio message and put it onto a player. It might be a CD. We might have recorded our message on a CD and mailed that person through a regular snail mail or the old mail system. And then the person gets it. They put the CD in their CD player, and then they listen to the message. So it's a lot like sending a letter too. We have to have certain message formatting and encapsulation. So we can say that we take our message and we put it inside of an envelope. We put it inside the envelope, and we have to address it. We have to say, who is the sender? Who is it coming from? Who is it going to? What are their addresses? So in this case, the sender is coming from Florida and sending that message to the recipient down in Ohio or up in Ohio. And we have to also, you know, make sure that our addressing is done properly. We have to make sure everything is formatted properly, or otherwise the U.S. Postal Service will not send that letter through. So it has to have certain formatting on there. We have to have the name, we have to have the address, we have to have the city, we have to have the state, and we have to have the zip code. We also have to say that we have a message size. We cannot send large messages. So just like in this example here, I cannot put a huge package. I cannot put a 50-pound package, take a 50-pound package or a dumbbell or a big box and send it with a regular letter with a stamp. I have to package that differently. So in the same way, when we're talking about networks, we have to set our network size our message size. So the size restrictions of frames require that the source break that message into individual pieces. So we take our messages. We take our message. So if we have a 20-page letter that we're going to send. We break that down into 21-page messages, and we break that down. And my drawing is not the best in the world, but you get the idea there. So we break that down into 20 different messages that we send, and that's known as segmenting. And so we set our maximum size, and we say, I've got a 20-page message here, but my maximum size is 1 page, so I'm going to break that down into 21-page messages or segments and send those through the network. So each segment's encapsulated, so we put each one in an envelope, and we send it across the medium. And then when it gets to the other end, they de-encapsulate it, and they put it back together, and they put all 20 pages back together, and they can read the message. So, just like size, we also have to have timing. We have to have a timing because we have to know our speeds. We have to have the access method. We know flow control and response timeout. Access method is, how are we going to access it? Which way is it going to access? The flow control, that's so that we don't get packets colliding with each other, that it knows the proper flow. And then the response timeout is we don't want packets hanging out too long. So at some point, if we're sending packets, they're going to flood the system and it'll just become overloaded. And so the response timeout shuts it down after a while so it won't overload the system. Okay, so real quick, when we do message delivery options, we have different ways. We can do unicast, multicast, or broadcast. Unicast, think of as one-to-one, or uni, or one. Multicast is where we're broadcasting multiple, and then broadcast is where we're just broadcasting it out and we don't care who hears. So multicast might mean that we know who we're identifying with, but then broadcast is just in general. And you'll learn more about those terms later on in the future chapters. Okay, so when we're talking about we know that we have to have the same language. We know we have to have sizes. We know we have to have the speed and all of that. But we also have to have protocols. This is what governs how we communicate in the networking world. So the question might be asked in normal communications: where's the cafe? And the conversation protocol suite, or the rules layer, says use a common language. Let's say we're going to use English. We have to wait our turn to talk so that everybody can hear. And we have to know when the signal, or we signal when finished. So if you think about back to the radio days when you were talking on, if you've ever talked on walkie-talkies or one-way radios, and I did this in the Marine Corps, we would have radios that would have one-way communication. And so I would one person would talk, and you would say, is my message coming through? Over. Over was my signal to say, hey, I'm done talking, it's your turn. CB radios might be another example of Citizens Band radio, might be another example of that. Okay, so the network protocols, they line out how the message is formatted or structured. They govern that. The process by which the networking devices share information, how and when error and system messages are passed, and then the setup and termination of data transfer sessions. So they do all that. That's what the network protocols do. the interaction of protocols, and you may not even know these as protocols, but that's what they are. So when we go to a web page in our browser, we rarely ever put in HTTP anymore. But the hypertext transfer protocol is what that is, but that's what the P stands for. But that's the HTTP, and most people don't using the internet don't even realize that today, that we're using a protocol to pull web pages across the internet. The transfer or transmission control protocol is part of the TCP/IP suite, but that's actually broken down into two separate protocols, the transport protocol and the IP protocol. And then you have the network access protocols, and that's the data link and the physical layers. But those are our interaction protocols. So the standards are set by organizations in the industry. We have different ones that are out there. Novell had their standards. AppleTalk had theirs. ISO come out with theirs. TCP/IP come out with theirs, and they followed down through. Novell had NDS, SPX, IPX, which were good in their days. I had some use with them back in the 80s, late 80s, or excuse me, in the 90s, early 90s. Mid-90s, using some of the Novell. TCP/IP, their protocols here, HTTP, DNS, DHCP, FTP, these are the more common ones today. So when we're looking down through there, you're going to recognize these, the IPv4, IPv6, ICMP, some of the lesser known, but they're still out there, ISO, and then the AppleTalk ones. That are out there for the industry standards. Now, and this one is just a chart of showing some of the older, it was the ARPANET and some of the older protocols. And then out of that came the development of TCP/IP. So, when we're talking about the protocol suite in communication, we are talking about this is the TCP/IP. This is not the OSI, this is TCP/IP. You have your network access layer, your internet layer, your transport layer, and your application layer. This does line up with the OSI. Layer or OSI, and we'll look at that side by side here in a minute. But you need to not memorize this information, but you need to be very familiar so that when someone you just need to know that the DNS is part of the application layer. You need to know that FTP is part of the application layer. You need to know that RIP, OSPF, ICMP is part of the internet layer. You need to know that Ethernet is at the network access layer. You need to know these. UDP and TCP are at the transport layer. That's just something that you need to memorize. And I said memorize. You just need to be really familiar with it. So that, well, I guess almost memorize it would be a good way to say it. These are some of the organizations that govern IEEE, IANA, ICANN. That's some of the governing bodies. The open standards, you can research these on your own. You've got the ISOC, you've got IETF, IEEE, ISO. Those are just some of the open standards, and again, the standards, the bodies, the governing bodies that set the protocols out. IEEE has just got some more information about it. You can go research that on your own. I'm not going to put that in the lecture portion here. So when we're looking at the OSI model, you need to know the OSI model to pass. Or for your Network Plus and for the CCNA, you just have to know it. So you just memorize it, get it burned into your head. You need to know the layers, you need to know the protocols of the different layers, and you need to know how they interact with each other. And this is a good example here. We have how I remember it is please do not throw sausage pizza away. That's my acronym. So that when I go to write it out, I can't. I'm not writing very well here today. But if we do the please do not throw sausage pizza away. And then I can go through and I can write out, that's the physical, that's the data link, that's the network, that's the network there. Transport, session, presentation, and application. And you'll if you when you go to do your certification, you're gonna get a whiteboard and you're gonna get a marker. And ask for a small marker because you're going to want to do a brain dump right at the very beginning of the exam or as your exam starts or right before your exam starts. You may be given a few minutes to prepare. And what you want to do is you want to do a brain dump. You want to write out the OSI model on that whiteboard or at least you want to write out the acronym so that you know how to break it down. You want to write out your subnetting charts. If that helps you, you just want to brain dump some of those things out, and you want to prepare for brain dumping that. And I'll do another video on certification preparation later on. Okay, so the other standards organizations, there's EIA. Well, let me back up here. There's EIA. There's TIA, Telecommunications Industry. Those are some different ones that you can research out on the internet or out on Google. Well, I'm losing my PowerPoint here. So, all right. Well, let me go on here. There we go. There's another presentation. This is the OSI model again. This is the TCP/IP model. They do line up to each other, and they work layered the same way. You have a packet that gets put together. Well, my pen is not working right. There we go. So you have a packet, or you have your information at the application layer, and it goes down the layer. It gets to your medium or your wires, your wireless, your fiber optics, however, and it gets sent along the wire. And it goes to the other side, and it goes back up that layer on the other side. The same thing happens with the TCP/IP reference model. You have a packet that comes out. That packet comes out. It then goes down the layer. Your network access layer is your wire or your wireless or your fiber optics, and then it goes back up. It's de-encapsulated, and then you can then read that information. When we compare these side by side, you can see that the TCP/IP model is a much simpler model. It's broken down into four bits or four areas versus the seven on the OSI model, but you still need to know the OSI. You do need to know the TCP/IP model too, and you need to know which protocols work in each one. So it's just something that you need to start memorizing for your certifications. Okay, well, that's a wrap on what we discussed for the first part. I'll wrap up in a second video for chapter 3.